Hello everyone, and thank you so much for joining me again on another Nikki's Awesome Biology, where today I'm going to be talking about a kind of protein purification called affinity chromatography, or affinity purification, where we can take beads inside a column and using this really cool kind of molecular Velcro, we can pull out proteins that we're interested in out of a protein mixture and end up with a pure protein sample. If videos like this help you out, smash that subscribe button, hit that thumbs up, leave a comment down below, and for now, hold on to your ligands and your tags and everything in between as we explore affinity purification. Woo!
So why would anyone want to purify a protein? Well, let's imagine that you've got a protein that you're really interested in. We're going to call it now the protein of interest. Now, one way that we can get a lot of copies of that protein made is that we can use cells, for example, bacterial cells, and we can actually get the cell itself to make up a lot of copies of our protein of interest. Unfortunately, those cells also have a bunch of proteins in them that we're really not interested in, and they're all jumbled up with our protein of interest. Now, we can kill that cell through cell lysis and break it open and release all of the proteins together into a protein mixture. And why is a protein mixture a problem? If we wanted to treat someone with a protein of interest, for example, diabetic patients with a protein insulin, we only want a pure sample of insulin. If you started injecting diabetic patients with a bunch of other bacterial proteins, it could lead to some really serious problems. But even aside from the therapeutic uses of proteins, if we just wanted to investigate the structure and the function of proteins, for example, with X-ray crystallography, it's a lot easier to do this if we've got a pure sample of protein.
That's much better.
Now, if you want to purify a protein, it can really help to have another molecule that will bind to your protein of interest. Even if you don't have an antibody that's specific for your protein of interest, you can add a little tag to the end of your protein, for example, hemagglutinin, that will bind to a corresponding antibody, for example, the anti-hemagglutinin antibody. You can even add an enzyme like glutathione S transferase that will bind to the glutathione substrate. Or you can add a little repeating motif like 6-histidine amino acids that will bind to the nickel metal ion. Whatever it is that you've added to the end of your protein of interest, we call this an affinity tag, and we refer to these proteins now as tagged proteins. And we refer to those little molecules that bind to those tags as the ligands. Now, something that's crucial with purifying this way is the ligands should be specific to the protein of interest. That means if we take all those other proteins from the bacterial cell that we're not interested in, they should just bounce off. See, I'm just bouncing off those ligands there. They're not binding. Now, in addition to the specificity between the ligand and its corresponding affinity tag, you also want the interactions between these two to be reversible. So here I'm using Velcro to represent a ligand and an affinity tag because they can bind and then they can unbind again like this freaky molecular Velcro.
Velcro, 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 molecular Velcro, 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 molecular Velcro, Velcro.
All right, time out. I know what you're thinking. Where did she go getting colored Velcro? Well, actually, I went into Spotlight and I got the normal white Velcro, and then I had a really crafty afternoon.
Now, the next step is to attach our ligand to something. This is a soccer ball. It represents a tiny little bead, something like 100 micrometers in diameter. And to this, I'm going to covalently link a spacer, which is just a little chemical chain. And then I'm going to covalently link the spacer to the ligand. Now, I don't just have one ligand attached to a bead. I've got many ligands attached to a bead. And in fact, I've got many beads.
And now we need the column. Now, the column is basically a tube, and it can be big like this or bigger and made of glass. Or it could be wee tiny like this and made of plastic. But however big it is, the basic anatomy is the same. The columns are packed filled with this material that we call the matrix. And what the matrix is made up of, if we could have a look, is, it's not made up of that. And no, that joke will never get old. In fact, the matrix is made up of those beads that we've just seen.
Those beads are made of something like agarose, and they're literally little tiny spheres with these ligands attached to them. If we could peek inside the matrix in a column, we would see it's made up of many, many thousands of these little tiny beads all packed down in there. And they are key to that magic of us putting a protein mixture in one end of the column at the top, and through a few steps, somehow getting a pure protein sample at the other end. Let's check it out.
Okay, I wanted to show you what's going on inside, so I made this column for you. It's open at both ends, and inside it is many thousands of beads. Now, I don't have that many soccer balls, so I've only put three in here, but it's also going to help me show you what's going on inside. Now, that whole column is going to be put into something that can basically catch whatever's coming out of the column. Now, the deal is that you're going to have your whole protein mixture, right? So you're going to have a sample that's got your protein, affinity tag protein of interest in it, but it's also going to have all this other junk from the cell, from the bacteria, and we call them non-specific proteins, the proteins that you don't want to be in there. Now, you're going to load the whole thing, probably with a pipette, onto the top of the column, and then through gravity
or by using a pump
or a centrifuge, that whole material is going to pass over those beads. Wow. Did you see that? If we take one of those beads out, we'll be able to see that there's this daisy chain. We've got our protein of interest. It's there attached to our affinity tag. That is bound to the ligand. The ligand was bound to the spacer, and the whole arrangement there is attached to that bead. So this is what we want to have happened, but it doesn't always work out exactly that way. Okay, so let's take a close-up inside the column to see what's happened here. Mostly, those non-specific proteins are just bouncing off the ligands. They don't care. And the affinity tag proteins are binding to the ligands. But we've got a protein that we're not interested in that's bound weakly to one of the ligands. Now, this is not something that we want. We'll take care of it in a sec. The final bead, I just wanted to show you that there are, in fact, some spots that aren't taken up with the affinity tagged protein of interest. If we have a look at all the stuff that's come through the column, we'll mostly have those that junky proteins that we don't want. But occasionally we'll also have some affinity tag proteins that'll make it through the column as well. Now, we've got our column. Oh, look at that bad boy. That's the one I want to get rid of. All right, that non-specific binding, he's got to go. So one way that we can do that is that we can change our buffer conditions. So this is the actual solvent or the liquid that we're going to be putting onto the column. And we call this a wash. We can decrease the pH a little bit. Woo! Come on, let's see that in column cam. We can change our buffer conditions, change the pH or the salt concentration. It'll disrupt the bonds, the weak bonds that are holding our non-specific proteins onto the ligands. But a little change like that, it shouldn't disrupt the strong association there is between the affinity tag and the ligand. So our proteins that are affinity tagged should stay attached to the ligands and in turn to the spacer and the beads. Okay, if we took our column out now, we had a look at what was in that tube down the bottom, catching everything, we'd see, well, a bunch of buffer, and we'd also hopefully see our non-specific proteins that had been washed off with that change buffer conditions off of the beads. That's not the only way to do it, though. We can use something we call a competitive agent. Now, just as an example, I'm showing you here, if we've got the affinity tag is 6-histidine, just have a look at the structure there. Now, we can use a competitive agent, imidazole. And if you have a look, the imidazole group, actually, it's there on both. It's there on the histidine. It's also there on the competitive agent. So the molecular structure of these two is quite similar. And what that means is both of these can bind to that ligand. Now, if we take a low concentration here of that competitive agent and we do a wash, then whoop, there it goes. That competitive agent, when we add it, thank you, column cam, when we add it, it's there, it's going to displace that non-specific protein. But at this concentration, it shouldn't displace the affinity tagged protein. Now, so far, we've just been looking at generalized ligand and affinity tag. It can be histidine and nickel. It could be hemagglutinin is your affinity tag with anti-HA antibody, or it could be GST is your affinity tag with the glutathione ligand. So whatever affinity tag and ligand you're using, you're going to want to get these proteins off of your column. You can't use them while they're stuck to the column. So we need to elute them. And one way of doing this is really changing the buffer conditions. Wow, did you see that? So if you make that buffer a really low pH, for example, or really change the salt, then that will be stringent enough to rip off those affinity tags off from those ligands. So if we could take a look at the beads now, we'd see still the ligands and the spaces are there, but all of the proteins of interest and their affinity tags should have been displaced, kicked off, and be down in this elution that we've now got.
But that's not the only way to do it. We can also add a different molecule. So for example,
we can also add a really high concentration of that same competitive agent. The example I gave before is imidazole. And this will work to actually come and if there's a high enough concentration, then it will displace those affinity tags. And so we will have eluted our protein of interest. And again, if we look down into that, what we've captured, our elution, then we should find predominantly our protein of interest still with the affinity tag intact. We can even do it a different way. We can add a very high concentration of just the ligand itself. So when we load this onto the column, that will end up binding to those affinity tags. So if we add that ligand in excess, I love that band.
In excess was a really awesome band.
Then this will work to bind to the affinity tag and elute our protein of interest. Yeah, how do you like that, bead? Now all the protein's been eluted off of you. How do you feel?
I'm lonely.
So a specific example of this one, I mean, if we're talking about an affinity tag protein of interest and it binding to a ligand, is when we've used the glutathione as transferase protein, the enzyme, and the glutathione is ligand, then we can add a bunch of glutathione in excess to our column, and this will end up binding to our GST tag, our glutathione S transferase, and it will elute all of the protein off. Now, whatever the affinity tag ligand pair that you use, when you look at the elution after you've added free ligand, you'll still have your protein of interest and its affinity tag, but in this case, it'll be bound to the ligand.
So let's put it all together. We've got a column. Inside it is upwards of many thousands of beads, and each one of those beads is attached to a bunch of ligands. We've also got a protein mixture, which contains our proteins of interest fused to affinity tags. In that mixture, though, we've also got all of these proteins that we're really not interested in. And we're going to load that whole mixture onto the column. Boo! And you'll see straight away, almost all of those proteins that we're not interested in, almost all of them, they just went right through the column and down into what we call the flow through. Now, mostly our proteins of interest, their affinity tags will bind to the ligands that are attached to the beads, and our proteins of interest will remain then in the column. Occasionally, we'll get a protein that we're not interested in, and it will non-specifically bind to a ligand and it will stay in the column, but we want to get rid of that guy. So the second step now is that we're going to wash our column. We can do this either with a low concentration of a competitive agent, or we can do it by changing the buffer conditions a little bit. If we, for example, added that competitive agent, you can see, boop, they can actually go and displace that non-specifically bound protein that we're not interested in and make him flow through the column as well. So now we've got this column that's basically bound with a lot of protein that we're interested in, but our protein is stuck in the column. So what we're going to do now is elute it off the column. And we can do this by adding a high concentration of a competitive agent, or we can change those buffer conditions quite a bit to make those proteins fall off. So if we did it, for example, with a competitive agent, let's have a look. We'll add it And that competitive agent will then go and it'll bind to those ligands and it will displace the affinity tags and so displace our proteins of interest, boop, so that they get pushed off the column and down here into our little tube, which now has our sample of pure protein. If this video helped you out, please give me a like, hit that subscribe button or write a comment down below. And I so look forward to seeing you on the next Nikki's Awesome Biology. Woo!
Nikki's Awesome Biology. Please subscribe, pretty please, for the cherry on top.